diamonds on the inside, sparkling from within. Hey, I'm Sarah.
Hey, I'm Trish.
And this is Trying to Win, our podcast about being trial lawyers, women in the profession, and
lots of fun
other stuff.
I mean, together we've been doing this. I was counting this today. I was thinking, like, how long, what's our collective years of experience? Do you know it's almost like 50?
Yeah, we can skip that and get right into what we're going to talk about
fair
today.
Fair enough. Well, it was a turning point for me when I realized my law license was old enough to drink.
Now we're getting past that. Moving on. Well, today's episode is really exciting for us. We have a special guest here today. We are going to be introducing you to the artist behind the Trying to Win podcast logo. She is also a lawyer in Charlotte who we absolutely adore, and her name is Sally Higgins. And so we're here to talk to her about her art and basically kind of how creativity impacts the practice of law, and that there are a lot of lawyers out there who happen to be creative, whether people appreciate that in us or not. I think people usually think we follow dictionaries mostly.
Well, yeah, pretty much. So the format for all of these, as you guys know, is an opening statement, sort of where we're going to go with this. And I think Sara just gave us a forecast by saying that there are artists in all of us, whether we're lawyers or we're real artists one way or the other. And then we'll do, after the opening statement, which we've done, then we'll do witness examination. We'll talk to Sally, get into some details and get to know her a little bit better and her art and her practice. Then we'll do closing points, closing argument. And then, of course, as always, we'll wait for the verdict from you guys.
Yeah.
Letting us know how we do.
Yep, absolutely. So,
do you want to introduce Sally formally?
I will, yes. Yeah. So Sally Higgins is a lawyer here in town. She practices with Higgins and Owens. Just to give you, gosh, a little bit of history, Sally and I started out knowing each other, I think, at Kennedy Covington. Yeah. Is that right? Yeah. And so that was back in the day, and it had to have been more than 20 years ago. And if I recall correctly, we have been pregnant at the same time at least once.
Yes.
Or at least overlapped, because our daughters are in the same years in school anyway. So that's how I got to know Sally, was through Kennedy Covington, and then just running into her at bar events and women's events all over Charlotte. And because of that connection, we, I guess, follow each other on Facebook, and Sally posts her art on Facebook. And I saw this painting and said, oh my gosh, that just strikes me. And I loved it. So, and I loved the story that you told about it when you posted about it on Facebook. So could you kind of introduce the painting for us and tell us the background of it?
Yeah. So, the painting is one that I worked on off and on over months, many months in 2020. And the way I paint, I don't really know where things are going when I start. So I'm not starting with a plan and then executing the plan. I start with just whatever strikes me that day, and it's then layers on layers, and something happens and it sends me in a direction, and I'll set it aside for a while and come back to it later. And that one, toward the end of 2020, started taking this brighter, more hopeful, you know, and I think it was the vaccine, and yeah, it was a new year, and it was the inauguration, and it just started going in that direction, although it really hadn't been that way before. And I finished it, I think, the day before the inauguration. So I'm watching the inauguration, and Amanda Gorman just blew me away, like she did.
Blew everybody away. She stole the show.
She really did. It was so incredible. And it just, she sort of gave me the title, but it was a weird moment, because it was, she articulated something that I hadn't articulated, but I think was coming out in the painting. And so I titled it Brave Enough, because those last lines where she talks about brave enough to see it and brave enough to be it, just, I mean, I just burst into tears, because
I think
it was
everybody
so
did.
Moving.
It was amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was incredible.
So, it's not necessarily, it's not that I sat down to say, let me make a painting about that poem, but it just struck
me. It's like a creature. Like it's a living, breathing thing that just kind of evolves with your emotion and your spirit.
That's good.
So how do you know when you're done? Like, how do you know, like, how does an artist really, like,
right? Not kind of like wrapping up a closing argument. You're not really, okay, now, like, what's the last line going to be?
Yeah.
Right? Like, how do you finish it?
It's a very hard question. And artists talk about it all the time, because you can overwork it and you can go too far and you can say, crap, you know, this really was better a few days ago before I started messing with this or that. And it's hard to know, particularly with abstracts, because it's not, you know, you're not trying to recreate a sunset, right, or, you know, a flower. It's something that you can't even articulate sometimes. And so it's hard to know. For me, what happens is I struggle. I hate it. I keep going. And sometimes with frustration, and I got to set this aside, you know, sometimes for years, and it's a way because I just don't know what to do with it, and I just can't figure out how to make it better. I just know it's not working. But if I keep going, suddenly I like it. And it's right. A really hard thing to figure out what's going to make that happen, because sometimes it happens quickly, and there's some paintings that seem like they just happen really easily, but mostly not. And mostly it's a longer process. And then somehow you just kind of know, okay, this is finished.
Yeah. So it's not like finishing up a closing argument where you can go back and say it was better 2 days ago, so I can go back and edit it.
Right. Right.
Right.
I've wanted to.
Yeah. So you can't do that with a painting. Are you stuck with it, or can you go back and kind of edit it and take it back to what maybe you liked 2 days ago when you realized you went too far?
You can try. And sometimes you can, and sometimes you can't. But, you know, you can paint over the top of it or scrape off or, you know, just completely start over. But that process of doing that is somehow that's what creates what's interesting, because things happen that you don't. And this is why, at least the way I paint, it's not a plan about, here is the painting I want to create and I can already picture it in my head and now I'm going to go execute it. It's much more of, okay, these are the colors I feel like working with today. And, oh, look, that's sort of interesting the way those two textures work together. And what if I take that a little bit further? And oops, no, that's too much. Or it needs some contrast. Or, you know, it's just a more intuitive, you know, back and forth kind of process.
I think that's called natural talent.
I don't think so.
Really? You don't think you were born with it?
No, it's a lot of practice. And there is a lot of technique and there's a lot to learn. And I have lots more to learn. But it's interesting to kind of learn to trust your instinct about what's working and what's not working. Yeah.
So what was it about the painting, the colors or the shapes in it that made it match for you with that brave enough line from the Amanda Gorman poem?
Well, some of it, the obvious part is just the light, that mm-hmm. yellow and the light that's kind
the
of
life
behind it.
Also, like it's very life-ish.
It's kind of active and there's sort of some steps and some, you know, path stones. You know, I mean, sometimes it's hard to kind of translate it into words of what it reminds you of, but it's... for me, it felt like it's a building and a hopeful, you know, something that just makes you feel good about what's to come. And
look what's come, right? And here we are. It's still like breathing. It's still changing. Yeah.
And now it's hanging in our office, yes, which we love. It's like
it
right at the end
so
of a hallway.
Well.
And it's so bright. We loved it. Yeah, it's perfect.
It fits. I got to send you a picture because
it looks great.
When my husband came and hung it, I was like, oh, my gosh, it just was. Like it's meant to be here, you know?
That's great.
So anyway, it's cool. It was, you know, painted by a strong woman, ended up being for strong women and for a strong program and inspired by a strong little lady. So
yeah, well, it's such an honor when somebody wants to have one of my paintings in their space, you know, and it's thrilling to me really. But, so thank you.
You're welcome. So I want to hear a little bit about the law part of things, to mix that in. We know you're an awesome lawyer. Your name's everywhere. Everybody in Mecklenburg County and probably far from here knows about you and knows who you are. Tell me sort of what inspired you in that way, in the art, in the lawyer way. Where's that spark?
You know, I just always wanted to be a lawyer, and it's kind of hard to really place when, because I've got one uncle who's a lawyer, but it's not in my family, and it's just, you know, so I don't know exactly where it came from, but it just always was what I wanted to do. And, you know, I've been really lucky to work with great lawyers and had great training. And I remember sitting, I don't know if you guys remember this, but just before you were starting to think about leaving your firm, your big firm where you had been, and you were thinking about going on your own, and we went to lunch.
We did. I remember
Carol Van Buren.
Yes.
She and I had lunch.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And you know, that was kind of a scary leap, and now it seems so obvious, and obviously y'all are just thriving out on your own, but you do have to kind of go back and think, well, lawyers are sort of risk averse, and the idea of leaving an established firm to start your own is a little scary. And but Carol and I had done it, I don't remember how much before that. But
it was
not
4 or 5 years before we did.
Before. Okay.
It might have been a little less than that. Yeah.
But and obviously it was a great move for y'all because you've just done great. But I don't remember why I brought that up.
I don't know. But we were talking about kind of how you got into the legal field. And kind of, you know, I'm always really interested in that intersection. You know, we introed today about kind of the intersection of creativity and the law, and that people don't realize how much creativity goes into particularly trial work, which is what you do. So, you know, we're all trial lawyers, and trying to figure out how to express something to somebody in a courtroom is a manner of creativity, you know, also depending on how you approach it. Now, I've seen people approach it, and it's really not creative. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if you are
creative. Or it can be too creative, which I have problems sometimes. Yeah,
sometimes.
Yeah. You get
yes.
too cute sometimes. Yeah, I know.
But, you know, the intersection of those and how they influence each other, I would be really interested because I have zero creativity outside
true.
Of the courtroom.
Oh,
outside of
I thought you were gonna say
what
Jim
I
Ross.
Do. Like, I don't paint. I don't make art. You know, I don't do any of those things. So I'm really interested to see if there's like an intersection of those for you.
Yeah. So I've really been thinking about this a lot because there is a lot of overlap, but there's a lot that's different that also informs each other. And so one of the things that I love about painting is it's not words. And what we do is words all the time. And we're trying to pick the exactly
right.
perfect word and write the most persuasive argument and deliver it in the most persuasive way. And it's logic and it's driven and precedent. And, you know, that's what we do. And so to get out of that, and I think that's why I'm drawn to abstraction, because it's not words and it's mm-hmm. not... I'm not trying to describe a specific thing in a specific way. It's just it's an expression and it's a feeling and it's color and relationship, but it is not about the precision that as lawyers, we just are constantly moving toward. And so that's kind of interesting. So it's not what it's not. And I like that, that opportunity to do something so different. So you think about our clients come to us and they don't want a lot of experimentation and, you know, well, maybe this will happen. And what if I tried that? They want
an answer to the question.
Right. They want an answer.
They don't want to be the test. Yeah.
And they want certainty and they want assurance in a very uncertain system. You know, we can't mm-hmm. tell them exactly what's going to happen. And yet we know that they really need to know and have some guidance about that. And so there's always that pressure to sort of bring clarity and some predictability to what's going on. And so to be released from that is a really fun part of the painting process. But there's also, you know, plenty of overlap in terms of you've got to learn the fundamentals and you know, if you heard this idea of how you acquire knowledge, and that at first it's unconscious ignorance. No, wait a minute. You say it. Unconscious unknowing. You don't know what you don't
right,
know.
Right, right, right.
And then you move to conscious unknowing. Okay, boy, I've got a lot to learn. I don't know what I'm doing. And then your goal is to get to unconscious knowing. So you just do it. And so you don't have to stop and think about every little step of the process. You're bringing your experience and your intuition. And, you know, that's true in law and painting. And, you know, you think about how hard some things were the very first mm-hmm. time you did them. But everything's different, you know. It's not the fact that you've done something before doesn't mean it's going to be the same this time.
Oh, no, yeah.
And the fact that you you thrive in that kind of profession, to me, says you are creative, because it's not a cookie cutter and you're not doing the same thing every time. And every case has got different personalities and different pressures and different budgets and different judges and, you know, all of those factors. So it's always a little bit different. And if you didn't have all those years of experience and the ability, yeah, the fundamentals with the ability to kind of bring the judgment and the creative part of, okay, how am I going to solve this problem?
Mm-hmm. So what you're saying, though, I when you were talking, it kind of struck an analogy with me to think about, you know, for all every case you get, you kind of have the bare bones of it. You've got the facts of the case. The case you get when it first walks in the door is never the case that you try. So while, you know, this idea of experimenting, I get what you're saying there, but there is also a process as your witnesses are going through, as you're learning more about the personalities, about the facts, what are their criticisms, you know, where are they, how are we responding to these things, where you do kind of get to erase a little bit on your palate and move backwards and then move forwards and let it build. And I mean, even when you start a trial, especially the long ones, they always end up in a different place than where you thought they were going to end up.
The focus seems to definitely change, which reminds me that the first day you brought the painting by, because you like, I know you liked it online, but you got to see it in person. And you brought it in and you were like, I painted it in this direction, but I actually think you could hang it. And I was like, that is so funny, because that's the way that I liked it, was the second way that you had pointed out. And so it really, I mean, it really is true, even with the paintings, that just because you start in one place doesn't mean that that's where you're going to end up.
Yeah, exactly. And sometimes it's just the turning it and turning it each direction, you see it anew.
Yep.
But it's the same process. And like you're saying, yes, the case doesn't end where it began. There's also, I think, a value, and my husband-in-law partner and I talk about this, sometimes when you're way down the road in the process, to stop and say, okay, what did I think? What was my gut about this when I first heard about it, or when I first met this client? Because you've traveled a long way from that, you know a lot more, but a lot of times that first thing you thought, you know, the first thing that you were worried about or that got you fired up is still
that thing
worth thinking about. And you have to kind of make yourself go back to, okay, what was it that, you know, I was right to be worried about that.
Right.
And I really need to be sure that I attend mm-hmm. to it, because mm-hmm. it hasn't really gone away. Or so.
Well, you have to watch yourself. I think we talk about getting into the weeds, you know, and when you get deep into a case or even into trial, sometimes you're so worried about hitting every ball that comes at you, you forget, you know, you forget your form, you know? And so I think that's a good point. Sometimes you need to take a step back and say, where are we again? What am I doing? Why am I doing it? And what are the consequences? What's the big picture here? You know, what's the theme, and does this really fit?
Yeah. Yeah.
You got to adapt, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Have you always painted? Like throughout your practice of law, have you always?
No, I have always done something creative, and I started painting about 10 years ago, and interestingly, I sort of fell into it because I had a case that was going to be going to trial. There was no way it was going to settle. I was just sure there was no way, and it was going to take 3 weeks. And so I had 3 weeks blocked off, and lo and behold, it settled at the last minute. And so I thought, okay, I'm rather than just fritter away this time, you know, I've blocked it all off, I've said no to stuff, I'm going to at least do one thing that is unexpected. And so I went and I looked around and thought about what it was going to be. And I took a 1-day workshop at the McCall Center that was a painting. And I had no idea what I was doing, but I just wanted to do something different. It was just, okay, what can I do that's not law? And it was great.
That's
okay. And it just, I
oh
fell in
God,
love immediately.
Love that
thing gave me chills. Yeah. That's really
I'm
cool.
Sitting here going, oh my God,
I'm gonna go
we have
paint.
To do
I'm
that as
today.
A team building like thing with the other lawyers in the office.
Yeah.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, and part of what was great about it was I knew I didn't know what I was doing. And so
yeah.
It was just, I was totally free to just play.
Yeah.
And I'm a lawyer. I'm not an artist. I don't know what I'm doing. And it was just so freeing, you know, and this wonderful outlet. And then, of course, not too much long later, after I'd been doing it for a while, I was like, well, okay, if I'm going to keep doing it, I don't want to be terrible at it. You know, that's not fun for that long. And so then the fight of, you know, your type A, like,
oh boy,
you know, that's sort of an interesting thing too. So I'm just trying to say, okay, wait a minute, I'm doing this because I want to do it. I'm not doing it because I have to. And it's, you know, it is still supposed to be fun. Mm-hmm. But, you know, sometimes I have to remind myself about that.
Yes. Do you find that it does help? Because we did talk a little bit before we went on about lawyers tending to become myopic, particularly trial lawyers. And if you have a very busy trial schedule, you know, it's hard to find those periods of time where you can find something else to do. Mm-hmm. Do you feel like it does give you kind of an outlet, helps you relax a little if you can put aside that type A personality for the painting part?
Yeah, it does. And I think the benefit, and I think this is true for all lawyers, probably all people, but just given the stress of the practice of law, to have something else, whatever it is, that you can get totally absorbed in, because there's plenty of things, you know, we're talking about running. I can keep right on worrying about work the whole time I'm running or fixing dinner or, you know, whatever. But there's certain things, and have some place where you cannot keep worrying about that case or that motion or what went wrong or, you know, what's going to happen next week. I think it's so valuable. It's just such a cleanse, and it doesn't have to be painting. I mean, I think it's
South Park Mall for me.
I can totally lose myself when I'm shopping. Anyway, I know that's not an art, but it works.
Whatever.
It's something different, right? Something
whatever
different
it is
work.
That just shuts your brain off for a few minutes. Yeah, no, I have to go. I ride the Peloton, and what I have it set up at home so that we actually cast it to a big screen so you feel like you're actually in a cycling studio, which, again, because we're recording during COVID, you know, our gyms and stuff are still a little bit difficult to access, but it also has this huge sound bar on it. And so, I mean, my neighbors probably hate me because I crank that music, and because you're having to pay attention to the instructor and do something different every 15 to 30 seconds, boy, you can't be ruminating about what's going on. You're waiting to see what the next move is. So, it helps to have those, even if they're short moments. They don't have to be long moments, but short moments where you get out of your own head.
But it's also why, you know, you go on vacation and you have to have that break, because you get too close to it, you get burned out. And so, you know, to have something in your daily life that pulls you out of it, to me, is really helpful.
Yeah. So it not only kind of helps you relax and get out of your head away from the law every once in a while, but also probably just helps you remember how to be that creative person also in the practice, which to us is huge. I mean, we talk about that all the time, about, you know, presenting in a way that's just a little bit different, a little bit unique. It doesn't have the heretofores and the wherefores and the herein's.
And comes the now the thereby's. Plaintiff. What does that mean? Now comes the plaintiff. I'm like, as opposed to later? Like, I don't get it.
We're deleting that out of everything at this point because it just doesn't make any sense. So, so that's great. Well,
I think the point is that when you are able to keep your creative juices flowing in more than just one direction at work, then you're able to continue to expand and kind of maintain perspective and keep the you-ness about you. You know, that makes us all great in the courtroom, the individuality part of it.
Yeah. Yeah. And just, you know, using all sorts of different mediums to help you get ready for trials, motions, meetings with clients even, you know, because those different ways of communicating with people only make us better as lawyers to be able to come up with different ways to deal with particularly difficult situations in the law as well. So
last question, are you brave enough?
Oh boy, depends on the day, right?
Yeah.
I want to be, you know, and we all want to be, but that doesn't mean there are not those insecurities that come out, but hopefully they make us better too, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Just put on some high heels and pretend like you've got it. That's what I do.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, Sally, it's been great. We so appreciate you being here, and we really appreciate the painting. We're loving it. And
it's beautiful. It's amazing. It's really, really cool.
I've gotten some great compliments on it too. So if anybody listens to this episode of the podcast, please comment on the painting for Sally. All of her information will be in the show notes, how to get to her paintings online, where she posts pictures of things, and we'll even try and include in the show notes a little bit about the story behind the Brave Enough title to the painting. So we really appreciate you being here. And
thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's really been a pleasure.
Yeah, and if we find another painting that we love, we'll bring you back and we'll have you talk,
we'll talk about it again. And we'll change our cover.
So, Trish, you want to give us the verdict on this one?
Well, we did our closing, right, which is just the intersection between art and the law. And that's kind of what we talked about today, and being the USU you can be. And then on the verdict, that's where the listeners come in, right? We want them to go on, rate, review, give us feedback. We can take criticism. We're really good at it, actually. Lawyers are all good at that. But yeah, let us know how we're doing and send us questions and keep in touch. We only know what to do when you tell us what you're looking for.
That's right. And we're now, I think, available on all of your favorite places where you get your podcasts.
Oh, yeah, Spotify. I didn't even know there were so many Google something podcasts. And
Tons of them.
Yeah, really cool. Apple.
Not sure we're allowed to say that, but okay.
Oh, whoops.
Well, we might edit that out.
Well, I guess until next time. Yep. Thanks.